So now we talk about scoring matrix, scoring the alignments. How do we know what a good alignment is and how the score is used? Particularly we talk about substitution matrices. So basically, what is the score you get when you align a certain letter to another letter? So the easiest one is the identity matrix. Basically, you get a score of 1 when you align two identical residues of 0 or everything else, or minus 1 or everything else, something like that. This is just a very, very simple matrix. But it's not optimal matrix. There are other matrices that are better. So the whole idea is basically what you want to do is you want to calculate the probability that two amino acids are aligned. And to do that, you need to have set of aligned residues and then calculate it. And so this is a bit of a moment 22 that you have to get an alignment, you need to have an alignment. But assuming that you somehow can get alignment, there's a different way you can do that. You can calculate the substitution matrices. And often they actually don't calculate the probability direct, but they calculate what's called log odds ratios. There's a number, a score. Basically, the observed frequencies and divided by expected frequencies. So basically, how common do we find amino acid I aligned to J given the probability of amino acid I alone and J alone. So that would be just because all amino acids are not equal frequency, otherwise I and J alone would be up to 5% each. So the reason to use a log arithmetic is just that you can actually, instead of using, if you use probability direct, you have to multiply the numbers, and the numbers will be very small, and that was at least traditionally very hard, costly to calculate on the computer. But nowadays, it might not be, but for sort of reasons, you use these log odds ratios, and just sum up the score step, and it's much faster. So there are, one of the first methods was called PAM matrices. They were divided by Margaret Dayhoff in the 1970s. And PAM stands for point except mutations, so it's a fraction of mutations basically. So how many mutations do you have? So PAM1 is 1% mutations. So 1 out of 100 amino acids are mutations. So and you can assume that PAM1 if you have two sequences that have a distance of PAM1, so they have one mutation every 100 amino acids, they're quite easy to align because 99% of the amino acids are identical, so basically the alignment is trivial. And then the idea is that you can actually calculate a PAM2 matrix from a PAM1 matrix by just multiplying the probabilities. So you can basically take the PAM4 matrix from a PAM2 matrix, etc., and you go on and calculate higher number matrices. So that you can have mutations that happens, you can calculate how frequent different mutations are. And actually, you don't start with the PAM1 matrix, normally you also start with the PAM30 matrix, something like that, and where you can PAM70 and the calculated matrix as high as PAM50. We actually have 2.5 mutations per amino acid. However, a mutation can occur, but it can also mutate back to the same thing. That doesn't mean that all amino acids are different. It means that on average it has been 2.5 mutations for each amino acid. And that means that some of them have changed several times and some have not changed at all. An alternative that was developed quite early are by Hennikoff, and it's called the Blossom matrices. And Blossom matrices was obtained from blocks of aligned matrices. You have basically parts of sequences that are aligned that you have studied and was manually aligned. And then you calculated these log odds ratios from these blocks. So for instance, if you have a block that was on average 62% identical, you could have calculated the block of 62 matrices. So you take all the blocks that were on average about 62%, and then you took them to calculate the block of 62 matrices. So here is the difference, is like it's not calculated from a low high identity and then multiplied, it's actually calculated directly from the observed frequencies. And in general you get actually slightly better line matrices from this that you have tested later, so that they are better detecting different homologs. And the reason, as I said before, is of course you have so the relationship between PAM and identity is roughly as shown in this plot. So, because amino acid can mutate several times, the identity doesn't decay linearly with PAM distance. So, roughly at 200 PAM, you have 30, 25, 30% sequence identity for proteins and a bit higher for nucleic acids. So this is how the PAM metric looks like. So you have the PAMs calculated, as we said, as we described before. And the PAM family of sequences is just multiplication matrices, the probability matrices. So they are not score matrices, but probability matrices. But you can then use this to calculate the scoring matrix. Well, the probability matrix first. We have 1 minus it, because we have to do that. And you can calculate the scoring matrix. Okay. So this is how a scoring matrix looks like. So you can see that there are lots of sequence information in it. First, you can see that all the diagonal elements are positive. They are below. And they are between 4 and 9, 11. The most conserved amino acid is the rarest amino acid, the tryptophan, which has the highest score, 11. And you can see that most of the off-diagonal elements when there are substitutions are negative, but there are some that are actually positive. So like for instance, aligning a tryptophan to a tyrosine gives a score of 2, and a tryptophan to phenylalanine, or tyrosine to phenylalanine gives a score of 3. So the group of aromats come together, and you can also see that the group of hydrophobic L, I, and M also sort of, come together and have positive scores. But also that arginine and lysine give a positive score, for instance, but they also actually have a positive score between positive and the negative charge amino acids, the glutamate and aspartate. And also, for some reason, you have some positive scores in serines and some amino acids. But in general, so you see the sequence amino acids that are similar to each other tend to give positive scores in elements. And then you see the tryptophan and cysteine are the two most conserved amino acids with really the highest scores. While, for instance, alanine is not as conserved. The Bose matrices, as we calculated from different types of blocks we align, we just calculate them. So here we have the blocks, and we calculate the probabilities, we can obtain all these matrices. And as a rough guide, PAM 250 is about log 45, but PAM 62 is PAM 160. Log 60 is about PAM 160. Sorry. And you see here, also here, you have a similar matrix with also all the diagonal elements be positive. The numbers are between 2 and 15, so it's a very wide range. Still, tryptophan and cysteine are the most conserved ones. And alanine is the least conserved one, which are 2. This tryptophan to other aromats is not, it doesn't give positive values anymore, but it does give some values about 0 minus 1. But still, tyrosine and phenylalanine have positive values. You see a group of all the charged one, now including histidine. Also, all positive charged residues are aligned together, but also the negative ones. Mainly, and also had the positive. The pattern is similar. There are a few more off-diagonal elements that end up to be positive. The pattern, for instance, for serine is slightly different, but it still has quite a low number for everything, basically. So you should remember that there are some fundamental differences between PAM and BLOSTEM. The PAM matrices are based on explicit evolutionary model. But in particular, the PAM matrices are rotated observed throughout global alignment and the that includes both highly mutable regions. But while BLOSTEM is only calculated from the part of the line, and they're not conserved. But particularly, the PAM matrices are obtained from the first initial alignments, while then they are multiplied. But in BLOSTEM, the calculations are on a later stage that have lower sequence of identity in these regions in general. And that means that somehow there's more of a selection pressure that is seen in the BLOSTEM matrix than in the PAM matrix. There's more a mutation matrix there. Because you can think about these mutations happening in like two things. One is actually you need to change the codons, you have to change the nucleotide. And as long as it's not too bad, it might happen by random. While if you give it more time, it actually might be selective advantage to be amino acids of similar types. It might be more of this amino acid similarity to those in the BLOSTEM matrix than in the PAM matrix. While parameters are more related to how far away to nucleotide codons are from each other. There are, of course, also BLOSTEM nucleotide matrices. Here, actually, you can obtain similar, yes, identity matrix is not that bad, and you can actually see that the inference, the day of spam matrix is basically one everything everywhere, or 1,000 case everywhere, and zero everywhere else. It's not exactly. But there are also other multiple matrices that are used that are maybe slightly better. The second part of an alignment, you know, is actually used how to deal with gaps. And there have been many studies and try to understand it, but in general nowadays all methods use two gap models. One calls for opening a gap, the second calls for extending a gap. Basically, it means that you have to make a short gap cost more relative to make a long gap. So you have a score of maybe minus 10 for opening it, and then every additional residue at the gap, if you want to score one, is one. So this you will see when we do the alignment later that we will use this.